Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our worship service this morning. I'm glad that you're tuning in with us during this live stream. We pray that you may be blessed as you worship God this morning in this format. Before we get going, I'd like to just announce that full council has a meeting tomorrow night via Zoom at 7:30. If you haven't had the Zoom password yet, please call Alicia. Psalm 100 says, "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to all generations." We would like to welcome Ken DeBoer to our pulpit this morning as he brings God's word to us. May you be blessed.
Good morning. Good morning, and welcome to worship this morning here at Maranatha in Bowmanville. My name is Ken DeBoer, and I'm happy to be here this morning to lead you in worship, even though it's from a long distance and we cannot be together. I would have liked to have been with you in person this morning. I would have liked to have met some of you and to get to know you a little bit better, but that's impossible today. So I'm coming to you from my home near Picton. In this service, we want to think about God's call on our lives, what that looks like, and how we as individuals and a church respond to that call, and how we might do that in the year ahead. Welcome to worship. And as we come to worship, we come as individuals. And we may come thirsty and parched, just like that garden that hasn't been watered in a long time. And we're welcome to come into God's presence this morning, because the Divine One is a spring of water. We may come from worry and from work, and we're invited to come into God's presence this morning because the Holy One offers Sabbath rest. We may come as those who are lost and confused, and we are welcomed into God's presence this morning because the Wise One welcomes us and gives us guidance. We may be bent over with struggle or with pain, but we come into God's presence because the Healing One empowers us to be strong. We come into God's presence this morning, welcomed and ready to worship.
Faithful, he will keep us day and night. Jesus, Jesus strong and kind. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to Him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to Him. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong.
We've been welcomed here this morning by a loving and a gracious God. And that God greets us this morning with these words: the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. And that God who just greeted us with grace and love and fellowship, that great and holy God, we recognize as Father, as King, as Lord in our lives. And as we do that, we recognize that we fall short of what that God might expect of us in our lives. Sometimes we fool ourselves and we say that we're completely put together. But if we say that, the truth isn't in us. But if we confess our distractions, and if we confess our anxieties, if we confess our errors, God will meet us, and God will renew us again. So I invite you to come in prayer this morning as we confess our sins before God and before each other. Father in heaven, we come to you. We come to you and we come to you before you and before all these people here with us watching this service this morning. And we confess that we have sinned again. In so many ways. We have been reluctant to speak out clearly to name the injustice that we see in the world. And we've not clearly shared your vision of flourishing for all. Before God and before each other, we confess our reluctance to receive our calling as God's people, made by God and chosen as God's witnesses. Witnesses to God's dream of justice and joy in this world. Remind us, Lord, that you have made us for your service. Recharge us with your word. Renew us, O God, and grant us the courage to live out your way of peace and grace. We ask this in Jesus' name, your Son, our Savior. Amen. In Psalm 103, we read, "The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as far as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Thanks be to God. Amen." Good morning, boys and girls, and welcome to my workshop. I thought that for our children's message this morning, I'd come to my workshop because I think it helps us to understand something about the message that we're going to have today from Genesis. So in my workshop, I build things. Right now I'm busy, I'm building wooden spoons. I carve these wooden spoons out of pieces of wood that look something like this, and we turn them into a spoon that looks something like this. And of course, I can't do that with my fingers or my teeth. I can try. But to make a wooden spoon, I use tools. I use tools like this one. This is a gouge, and here I have a knife, and here's another knife, and I might use a tape measure to measure it. I might use a pencil to draw the picture originally. And so all of these things come together to help me to make the spoon that I have a vision for. And so I take this tool, this is the gouge, and I can take this tool and look at the beautiful pieces of wood that it gouges out of this, so that I can turn this piece of wood here into a spoon. Now, this gouge is probably the best thing to use for this. I could probably try to use a screwdriver, couldn't I? And I could jab at this piece of wood with a screwdriver, but it doesn't make the nice flakes of wood, the nice curls of wood don't come off it the same way as this tool, because this is the right tool for the job. It's the tool that's been made for the job. And you know something? You've been made for a job too. God has a job for every one of you. God's got a vision for this world, for the way that the world should be and the way that the world should look. And each one of us has a job, a calling. We call that a calling. Each one of us has a job that we're to do in that. And for each one of us, just like this tool is specially made for this job, you've been specially made to do the job that God has in mind for you. Now, right now, you might not all know what that is. You may not have any idea what the job is that God has for you. But God has one, and you just need to be listening. Listen for God's call. Listen for God in many ways, through your friends, through your relatives, through your family, through your pastor. Listen for God's voice saying, here's what you need to do in the world. so that my vision for the world can be found. Just like I have a vision for what this spoon was to look like, God has a vision for the world too. Bless you, and God be with you.
God made the earth and filled it full with seas and trees and animals, and then he made a man. But Adam, he was incomplete, so God gave him a helper, Eve, to carry out his plan. This happy husband and his wife, they showed the world what God is like until they disobeyed. Though they lost it all, we still see fingerprints of God in everyone he makes. We are the image of the God of all the world. He made us boy, he made us girl. Different pieces of the puzzle joined together perfectly. We are just the way God wanted us to be. We're shades of brown, we're short and tall, but God himself designed us all unique, so we could see. He wants each one to play a part, to show the world the Father's heart, to have a family. We are the image of the God of all the world. He made us boy, he made us girl. Different pieces of the puzzle joined together perfectly. We are just the way God wanted us to be. We are just the way God wanted us to be. We are just the way God wanted us to be.
It's my privilege to lead you in congregational prayer now. And before we go in prayer, just like to remind you that we did record this on Thursday evening, and this is the needs as we knew them at that time. Psalm 55:22 says, "Give your burdens to the Lord, and he will take care of you. He will not permit the godly to slip and fall." What a wonderful promise. Let's do that. Let's lean on that promise as we go to God in prayer. Lord our God, you are a great and wonderful God. We give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. Lord, as we worship you, we know, we know that you are above all things, and yet you are intimately concerned about our lives. Lord, we thank you for that, and we rest in that comfort that you know us so well, and you know us about what we all need. Lord, thank you for the sun that could shine. Thank you for the colder weather. And Lord, even though some people may not like that, others do, and we pray that you would allow us to just enjoy each day that you give us, whether it's cool or warm, sunny or cloudy. Lord, we thank you for them. Lord, we come before you with a number of praises. Lord, there's people in our congregation that are rejoicing. Lord, we're grateful that Pete and June could have traveled and seen her brother Dave. We thank you, Lord, that he is doing well and that he's back home again. We thank you, Lord, that they had that opportunity to go and do that. And we pray, Lord, that as they make plans to travel home again, that you would bless their travels. Lord, we want to give you thanks and praise for complete healing for Steve Driesman with his detached retinas and his eye surgeries. Lord, we want to thank you that he is up and well again and that he can continue to be a productive member of his family, of his society. And Lord, we want to thank you for that healing that has taken place there. Lord, we want to thank you that Joseph Bowman can be coming this coming Saturday on the 16th. Lord, we want to thank you that you have provided Joseph for a while here as he serves as interim pastor. Lord, we thank you that you have fulfilled the vacancy here, that even for a little while, that we may have some continuity. And Lord, we thank you that that you have allowed him to finish his studies. We pray, Lord, that you would give him a safe travel. We pray, Lord, that you would allow the border crossing to go well. And we also pray, Lord, that as he quarantines here, that you would allow him to do that in a good manner, that it may not be a hard hardship for him. Lord, we thank you that we have a search team in place and that they are looking for our next pastor. Lord, we thank you that the technology is available, that we are able to meet together. We thank you, Lord, that that's available. And we pray, Lord, that you would just bless their efforts as they search for our next pastor. Lord, you know who that is. And we pray, Lord, that you would work in their heart, that they may be ready when the call does come. And Lord, we heard this week that you have called Allie Dykstra home. Lord, we want to thank you for who she was and what she meant to us here at Maranatha. And for her family, those that love her, Lord. And yet we want to thank you that you have allowed her to enter her rest in your glory. Lord, there are others that are missing her. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with her family, that you would be with Alex and Jeanette and Lorraine and all those that are involved with Allie Dykstra. We pray that you give them what they stand in need of as they mourn the loss of a mother, a sister, and a friend. And we pray, Lord, that they may rest in your comfort, that she is home with you. Lord, we have a lot of concerns yet, too, in our congregation. There are many things that are happening. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with Jessie Mostert. Lord, she is struggling with mobility issues, and we pray, Lord, that you would help her with that you would make things easier for her. And Lord, we also know that she has her left hand is bothering her quite a bit, and we pray that you would allow that to subside. And Lord, we pray for Carol and Cor Mostert with their various health concerns. And we pray, Lord, that as they await test results, that you would be in the midst of that couple too, that they may rest knowing that you are in control of all things. And we pray, Lord, that you would bring healing there and peace. Lord, we know that Jerry Hellinga is struggling with his health and that he's undergoing tests to see whether they can figure out what is going wrong. And Lord, we pray that you would be in that situation there too, even though they don't know what exactly is causing some of the struggles with Jerry. We pray, Lord, that you would guide the medical professionals, that you would allow them to diagnose what is going on there, and that he may be able to regain full health again. We don't ask this for ourselves. We ask that, Lord, that he may be a father in his family, that he may be a husband in his family, and that he may continue to offer service to you, and that he may be able to get back to work again. Lord, we do pray for the Hellinga family as they also mourn the loss of a loved one a little while ago, and we pray, Lord, that you would just give them what they stand in need of. Lord, we know that Rink is scheduled for surgery, and we pray, Lord, that things may go well with him, and we pray, Lord, that you would guide the surgeons also. We pray that Rink may end up having a full and complete recovery also. Lord, we pray for Jennifer Semplonius. Lord, as she undergoes her chemo treatments, we pray that they may be a successful course for her, that they may stop what is attacking her body. And we pray, Lord, that that you would be with Jennifer and Gary. May you give them what they stand in need of, and may they know that through all of this that they are the children of you and that you have them in your hand. Lord, we pray that it may be something that brings glory to you. Lord, we pray for Helen DeJager and Yvonne and the rest of the DeJager family, John and Joanne and the rest of the family as they mourn the loss of a loved one, a brother and a son. And Lord, we pray that you would just give them the comfort and grace that only you can provide. And we pray, Lord, that you would allow them a rich measure of your peace. Lord, we continue to pray for Nathan Terry. Lord, it's so hard on Royal Liz to see Nathan like that. And we pray, Lord, that you would allow Nathan to wake up, that he may be a brother again to Matt and to Angela. And Lord, we pray that he may be able to have a healing in his body and his mind. But Lord, through all of this, we hear testimony of how you are working through this situation. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to work through the situation, that this may be something that brings glory to you also, that we all may turn to you and realize that you have Nathan and the whole Terry family and everyone that loves Nathan in the palm of your hand, and that he is not out of your thoughts. Lord, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9 says, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness." And Lord, through all of these situations, and even the ones that aren't said, we pray, Lord, that we all may clasp on to that promise of yours, that your grace is sufficient, and that your power works in our weaknesses. Lord, as our thoughts go out to a further, our society and our town and our country, Lord, there are so many things that are happening out there. Lord, this COVID pandemic is causing people to be upset. It's causing people to get COVID fatigue. It's causing people to look for various reasons why and various ways of trying to deal with this. We pray, Lord, that you would bring healing to our world, that you would allow us to know that you are in control. We thank you, Lord, that the vaccines can start to roll out, and we pray, Lord, that may go smooth. Lord, we pray for those that have been suffering layoffs because of this. Their financial security is not there so much anymore, and we pray that you would be with them. Lord, we heard again that school will stay out now for another couple of weeks. And Lord, that brings its own set of challenges. There are families that struggle with this because now how do they deal with daycare and how do they deal with work and how do they, and it's just a lot. And we pray, Lord, that you would be in all of these situations. Lord, that you would grant grace and peace and patience where it's needed. And Lord, we pray that our families may understand yet again that you are in control. And Lord, as we look to the South and the things that are happening in the U.S. and the politics that's happening down there and the unrest and the rioting, again, Lord, this is something that we're not sure how to take, and we're not real sure what's all going on down there. But Lord, we know that you have all things in control. Will you help us to rest on that? Lord, there are so many things that we think about, so many concerns and joys that we all share. And this is just a small little taste of what we think and what we are worried about and what we praise you for. Lord, you are a great and glorious God. And we thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. Ephesians 3:20. Now all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. Glory to him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord. He is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said? To you who for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with you. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am your God and will still give you aid. I'll strengthen and help and cause you to stand upheld by my righteous omnipotent hand. When through the deep waters I call you to go, the rivers of sorrow shall not overflow, for I will be with you, your troubles to bless and sanctify to you your deepest distress. Fiery trials your pathway shall lie. My grace all sufficient shall be your supply. The flame shall not hurt you, I only design your dross to consume and your gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus has leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foe. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
We have the opportunity again to open God's word this morning. And so I invite you to take up your Bibles wherever you are, then open them this morning to Genesis 12. And we're going to read the first four verses this morning from Genesis 12. But before we do that, let's come to our God in a time of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you've given us this word and that we can hold it in our hands and that we can know you better through it. And we can also know how you have called us, the call that you put on our lives through these words. And so, Father, we pray that as we read these words this morning, as we hear your word through your servant, we pray that our hearts would be open, that your spirit will be with us and will carry those words directly to our hearts and our minds. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. We read this morning from Genesis 12, verses 1 to 4. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. So far, the reading of God's word this morning. Here we are. Here we are, the second Sunday of 2021. The year 2020 is behind us, and it is something like a dark cloud, something that we'd like to forget, but a year that's going to live on in our memories. 2020 was a difficult year. It was one filled with fear and uncertainty, with isolation and anxiety, with interruptions in our familiar and our well-loved traditions and patterns. We're only a little ways into 2021. And it stretches out in front of us, something like a clean slate or an unbroken field of snow, a blank piece of paper. Not much is written yet on this year. And every one of us has ideas about what should be written. We all have hopes and dreams about this year. All of us share the dream of the rollout of a vaccine with the hope that by late 2021, life can return to something that we would describe as normal. And we can get on with our plans to move to new homes, to take trips, to have vacations, to celebrate those special family events, weddings, anniversaries, birthdays. And we have hopes and plans for our church as well. We hope that here in Bowmanville, our church will continue to be strong, that we'll continue to find ways to support each other, that Maranatha will continue to grow. And we hope to continue to be a presence in our community, bringing God's kingdom into reality for those around us. We desperately hope that sometime in this year we will be able to worship again in old familiar ways, that we'll be able to sing together again, that we'll be able to hug and shake hands, that we'll be able to enjoy coffee together. We stand on the brink as we move into this new year. We stand on the brink of something new, something that may be raising a number of emotions in us: anxiety, anticipation, concern. In our scripture reading today, we're invited into another beginning of something new. As Abram is called by God to be the father of a great nation, the father of God's covenant people. And we have to wonder, what is Abram thinking as God leads him to that edge, to the brink of something that's both exciting and fearful, something that's unknown. We have to wonder about the emotions that are flowing through Abram as he ponders the question, why me? Why has God chosen me to go and to leave everything? I'm sure that he felt fear. I'm sure he felt doubt. I'm sure there was even a sense of anticipation mixed with the incredulity of it all. We first meet Abram at the beginning of Genesis 11. There's a genealogy there, and that genealogy moves the focus of the narrative from the broad visions of the goings on at Babel and the scattering of the people all over the earth to a narrow and focused frame. And inside that frame, we find a man named Abram. But would we expect to find someone with such poor prospects in that frame? Of all the people that God could have chosen, why does he choose to go and visit Abram? Abram's wife is barren. And as we read further in Genesis, it becomes very clear that Abram doesn't have any children already. And childbearing years are long past. Abram has no offspring. And it would appear that Lot, Abram's nephew, is being groomed to be the heir of whatever Abram leaves behind. So what did Abram do to cause God to call him? It would appear that the answer is absolutely nothing. In fact, because of the barrenness of his wife, the choice of this particular man seems a little more than unlikely. Adding to the unlikeliness of this choice, the book of Joshua suggests that Abraham did not necessarily worship God before his call, at least not exclusively. So Abram seems like a pretty unlikely candidate for God's call. God's call to go and to leave everything behind. It doesn't look like it was because of his pious worship that he was chosen, or because of his family-making ability, or even his character and faithfulness. If we continue to read Abram's story, you'll find out that even after the wonderful call and the promise of blessing, Abram continues to make mistakes, continues to try to run his life without God. His call has nothing to do with anything that Abram himself has done, or anything that he, on his own, will do. He is chosen through God's grace. From all the residents of the world, many of them with better prospects than Abram, at least from our perspective. And yet, God singles him out from everyone else, comes to him one day, and sends him on a journey. Sends him on a step into the unknown. We might find ourselves identifying with Abram this morning as we've begun to venture into 2021. Realizing that we too have been called. We too have heard God say in one way or another, go, leave. While the book of Genesis doesn't record any of Abram's objections to God's call, just knowing what we do about him, we can imagine that he had them, just like we do. We often argue ourselves out of responding to God's call in our own lives and in the life of our church community here in Bowmanville. We feel that we're not ready to start the journey. We need more planning, we need more training, more preparation. We need more financial security before we can step out on the path that's been put in front of us. Some of us, like Moses did at his call, we'll come up with excuses, we'll dredge up weaknesses, we'll point out our inability to even approach the task that's before us, let alone accomplish it. We can come up with so many excuses for not answering the call that by the time 2021 is over, we'll find ourselves no further than we are today, afraid to step out in faith, proving to ourselves that we weren't ready. We do this as individuals. We also do it as a church. We belittle ourselves. We argue that we are too small. We're too old. We're too tired to step into God's call. We feel we have nothing to offer and that what we have to offer is already spoken for, used up. And in many ways, we're right. Our lives are as barren and as empty as that of Abram. We too, under our own power, in our own human estimation, lack what it takes to accomplish what God has in store, what God has planned for our lives and our church in 2021. We're not up to bringing the kingdom into our community. When we look at our own lives critically, we argue that what we have to offer is lacking, it's empty, it's barren. And we're right. And it's into this barrenness, Abram's and ours, that God comes. Now God said to Abram, and an adventure begins. The first time that we heard a phrase like that, that phrase, the Lord said, was at creation. When God said, let there be light, and there was light. And the mantra continues through the creation story. And God said, and the world was created from chaos, from barrenness. The world that we know with all of its beauty, all of its complexity that we enjoy today. From Abram's barrenness, God says, and a nation is created. A nation and a lineage that will one day bring the Savior into the world. God does demand a faithful and obedient response. And he asks a lot of Abram. Go from your country, your people, your father's household to the land that I will show you. It's a simple mantra, go and leave. The obedience demanded becomes more and more pointed from the broad expanse of country to the intimate safety of a father's house. But the blessing promised far outweighs the losses if God is to be believed. Abram is asked to be obedient. The rest is God's work. It's not Abram who is charged with building a great nation. God promises it. It's not Abram who will work hard to build a name for himself. God will do that. It's not Abram's work ethic that will bring blessings his way. God will send those. The work is God's. Abram is merely called to be obedient, to go and leave. In his lifetime, Abraham, as he's later called, doesn't even realize most of these blessings. He dies with two sons, one from Sarah, his legitimate heir, and the other through her servant who has been cast out. A sort of wimpy beginning for the great nation that was promised. He never got replacement land for the land that he left behind in Haran. Not very many people were blessing each other using his name. Most people didn't even know who he was. I'm sure there were days when he wondered if the blessings that had been promised were real, if God really cared about him. or if he followed a hoax. I'm sure there were days when he saw the future as a bleak and frightening possibility. He may even have had days when he wondered if the calling that he heard was real. Days when he doubted God's promises. And yet we know the rest of the story. We know the blessings did come. And a great nation was born that day from a man and his barren wife. We know that Abram's name does become great even today. It's a name revered in the three largest religious traditions in the world: Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. All of this created by God's grace, through God's work, from the barrenness of Abraham's life. God promised Abram blessing for faithful obedience. And he does that for us as well today. God, through Jesus Christ, has come into the world, has walked among us, has suffered with us, has died for us. And now, his Holy Spirit comes to us and says, go, leave. Go and walk in that new life that I have for you. Leave your old life behind, and I'll give you the strength to do it. Remember these words of Jesus: whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Go and leave. Doesn't that sound like Abram's call? He was asked to give up the place where he lived, his relatives, even his place in his father's house. All of the things that he held dear, he was asked to deny himself. And while these words of Jesus don't hold out a blessing for those who answer that call, later in Matthew, Jesus speaks again on the same topic. Everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or fields for my sake will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life. Go, leave, and I will bless you. Leave the things of this world, your old life, and come to a new place, a new land, a new life that I will show you. I will take your barrenness, and I'll do great things with it. God knows that we cannot answer the call in our own strength. God sends his Holy Spirit to be our guide. And even so, like Abram, we continue to fail. We continue to fall short in really answering the call. We try to do it on our own. And we realize that any good and obedient thing that we accomplish has been done not by our strength, but through the power of the Holy Spirit, sent to us by the one who sacrificed his life for us, Jesus Christ. I wonder, as Abram heard God's call to go and leave, was he able in any way to conceive what God was offering him? Did he have any idea that what these promised blessings meant? Or did he just recognize through faith that God's grace would be enough? What about you? How is God calling you today to go and leave? How is God calling us as a community here in Bowmanville? How is God calling us to step out in faith in this year ahead of us? Taking up that call, trusting in a God who will provide the strength that you need for the task will put you on a road to adventure, put you on the road to being a blessing, God's hands and God's feet in this world. as we look at the rest of this year in front of us with anticipation or with trepidation, we know that God calls us to go and leave. And as we do that, God goes with us, in front of us and behind us, beneath us and above us, with us into this new adventure. We step out in faith, knowing that God's grace will be enough for us. Please pray with me. Father, we pray that you would mark us with grace and blessing. Help us to answer your call on our lives. Let our lives reflect your light and your goodness, so that in the way we live, we would bring others to an awareness of your presence and your love. Teach us to trust you with our whole heart and to praise you in every circumstance, so that your grace and mercy might reach out through us to the entire world. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands at victory, since Christ has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home,
can ever pluck me from his hand
till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
Today's offering is for Therefore Go Ministries, formerly called Youth Unlimited. Therefore Go Ministries seeks to assist churches with their ministry to youth and emerging adults through training, coaching, and peer learning. Hearing and responding to God's call on our lives doesn't end at graduation. It's a lifelong process. Therefore Go is here to provide resources and advice for parents and church leaders to have rich and impactful conversations about their purpose, call, and direction with youth and emerging adults. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your many rich blessings. This morning we would like to lift up in prayer the Therefore Go Ministries. We thank you for this organization. We ask that you will bless our offering this morning, and may it be used for your used to glorify you. Amen.
Go now. As those invited into God's future, where the one who makes all things new has made his home among us, we are called and chosen, together embraced by the God in whom tears and mourning, crying and pain, and even death will be no more. This is God's future. This is our story. And as we go, may grace, mercy, and peace from the Creator, Savior, and Counselor be with you now and forevermore. Amen.